Samueli Institute headquarters in Alexandria, Virginia, this is On Human Flourishing. I'm Dr. Wayne Jones. Our guest today is Dr. Ian Coulter, a senior health policy analyst at the RAND Corporation, where he holds the Samueli Institute Chair in Policy Research for Integrative Medicine. Dr. Coulter is one of the premier thinkers in integrative medicine, including traditional, complementary, and alternative practices. He has a doctorate in sociology and has done extensive studies into research methodology and chiropractic care. I want to start a little bit first, just talking about sort of how you got into these areas. You didn't start off in integrative medicine. You started off in hardcore basic sociology research, right? And started off in Canada. And tell me, how did you get into these? I don't actually know the story behind this.
Well, I was actually a medical sociologist by training, I suppose. And I was actually teaching at a university in Northern Ontario in Canada, and the University of Toronto Medical School got a grant to study chiropractors. And they had been critiqued about they had no theoretical framework for the study. And so a friend of mine who was an anthropologist had said to the PI of that project, I'm working with this medical sociologist, he might be an interesting recruit. So they contacted me and said, you know, we've got this very large grant, would you like to join us? And so I joined them to develop the not only the research methodology and the field study, but also to frame it theoretically. And I looked at it as a sort of exercise in social legitimation, mm-hmm. that chiropractors had every kind of legal legitimation, but they still, their knowledge base was not considered legitimate, so they suffered quite badly from that. So I had nothing to do with comprehensive alternative medicine until I did that study. Mm-hmm. And then I did the study, and like many others, I sort of got converted because I came across an institution that had built their own college, no government funding. They produced very good graduates. We then went out and studied all the practices in Canada where they had a patient population that was incredibly satisfied, like over 90% satisfaction rates. And, so everything we looked at, we thought, this is amazing. Here's a group that's giving what is really valued healthcare, people are willing to pay for it, and they're willing to go to extraordinary lengths to get it. They're highly satisfied with what they get, and yet here they were being blatantly, that the profession was being discriminated against. They were excluded from university, they weren't allowed to practice in hospitals. And I actually thought as a sociologist, and sociologists tend to think like this, that this was an amazing violation of human rights, that, that this just was not legitimate. And so I suppose this is in the 70s, and of course, sociologists had been at the forefront of the 60s for the feminist movement, the civil rights movement, the gay movement. There's hardly a sort of liberation movement that sociologists haven't sort of been involved in. And yet here was really what was a gross violation of civil liberties, and I thought sociologists were quite quiet about it. They weren't saying anything about it, and that sort of puzzled me. I mean, why? Why weren't people sort of saying something about this? And so, and then I thought, you know, chiropractors were suffering from not being in the university. If they were given all the opportunities that medicine had had in the university environment, the intellectual resources and so on, what might they have achieved, you know, given that they had to build their own college? And quite clearly, it was a modest college. I mean, they did have a great school of anatomy and human dissection. It was amazing what they built. All from their own money, no taxpayers' money, no public funding, and so on. So, and in Canada, all universities are public universities. There's no private universities. So I thought, well, maybe I'll join them and help them get into university. And I thought that'll take, you know, maybe 3 to 5 years. Here we are, 30-something years later, they're still not in there. So I totally underestimated the depth of the bigotry, and I also totally underestimated the power of the universities to keep them out. So that's how I came to be involved. Integrative medicine came later.
Right. So this is fascinating. Help me understand this. I don't think most people in the conventional or in the complementary medical field see it like this. I don't think. No. I mean, you talk about the reason that it's perceived or could be perceived as a violation of civil liberties or human rights, a violation of human rights. Is because here is something that is paid for, desired by, used, satisfied by the public, desired by the public, and yet in the power structures and the resource and the financing is basically either ignored or suppressed in some way. Framing that as a civil right or as a violation of human rights is a fascinating way to do it. I mean, I don't think that's certainly a different way of looking at it. Is that how sociologists would be looking at it?
Well, it is because, I mean, discrimination, the way we define discrimination is any group who for some cultural or social reason is separated out for different treatment and unequal treatment, that's an act of discrimination, right? Mm. So there's no question that that's what's happened here, that the universities are not given the power to decide which medical professions are legitimate or not. There's a political process by which you become a profession, and then you lobby and you get registration and you get licensure and you get all those kinds of things. And by the time I got involved, chiropractors were legitimated in every state and province in North America. There was no state in America that hadn't already licensed chiropractors. They had colleges that met accreditation standards, not only professional accreditation, they even have university accreditation. So they'd met all the standards you have to meet to be a fully developed and accepted health profession. And yet the universities seem to obtain upon themselves to then decide who gets in, right? Mm-hmm. So think about it. Medicine got into the university because they were so bad before the Flexner Report, they put them in the university to clean them up. I mean, they weren't scientific prior to they got into the university. And you could say that for nursing, pharmacy, and dentistry. All of them went into the university to strengthen their program, right? So none of them could claim to be scientific outside the university. And even in the university, you could debate about how scientific they are. I mean, think about it. They think about 20% of medicine is truly evidence-based. So the argument they've used to keep chiropractors out is that somehow chiropractors are not scientific, right? Well, excuse me, neither were you before you were in the university, right? And then secondly, they will use the argument they constitute a danger to the public. If that's the case, you really want to put them in an institution where you would improve the quality of their research and their safety, the same as we did with medicine. 50% of all medical schools were closed after the Flexner Report. 50% of all the schools in North America, they were so dangerous, they closed them, right? So here we have a situation where those in the club, inside the university, are lobbying to keep those who aren't in there out. And you can't argue that chiropractors are no longer legitimate. And even on a research basis now, Wayne, you know, you think about there's probably 50 or 60 random controlled trials now manipulation. So you can't argue that's any longer the case, and yet they're still excluded. So at some point you have to say, why is that? Why is it that no leading prestigious university will let them in? Now look at the response to acupuncture. Nixon goes off to China. Some people traveling with him see these extraordinary things that have been done with acupuncture. Yeah. Without any research basis, without any evidential basis, what happened? Medicine bought acupuncture in the university. So they got into the university in a whole bunch of places without any evidence base at that time. You know, we could talk about the evidence base now, but for some reason, the evidence base didn't seem to matter in their case, right? Mm-hmm. And that's probably because they were co-opted. They became part of medical practice.
I see. So what are the drivers here? I mean, this is fundamentally seems to be about power in some way. I remember one of the first conferences that you participated in that we held at NIH when I ran the Office of Alternative Medicine was a conference on epistemology around these areas. We were looking at the whole issue of assumptions and paradigms and definitions. And I remember, I think you and another sociologist from Brown University came up with a definition of integrative or alternative medicine. Actually, integrative medicine wasn't even on the field at that point. It wasn't even a word, but it was complementary and alternative medicine that defined it in sociological terms and in power terms, whereas everybody else at the time was trying to define it in scientific terms. But you're telling me that was really a runaround. It was a distraction. Can you talk a little bit about how that happens and what that means in terms of being able to address this civil rights issue?
Well, I think, you know, most sociologists of that perceptive will have actually noticed that there has been a social revolution occurring, sort of quietly, but it's been occurring nonetheless. And there's a very significant event that happened to make it possible. But for 100 years, the relationship between medicine and any of the alternatives was pretty hostile, pretty bad, and between chiropractors as bad as anything. But I will tell you, in the early days, the fight between osteopathy and medicine was just as bad as a chiropractic one. Until osteopathy became part of medicine, it was a very hostile kind of environment as well. So sociologists looking at that will actually tell you that this actually is a political process. Becoming a profession is a political process, and it is about power. And the power is because in the health field, medicine has dominated. So because they were, once they went to university, could claim to be the best educated. They did anatomy, neurology, physiology, dissection, the only ones who could do human dissection. They could claim that they should be the gatekeepers, that they could be the only profession that were the primary contact, and then everyone else would be under referral. The exception was dentistry, where they were quite willing to give the oral cavity over to dentistry without having referral. But in any other area, if you look, say, take physical therapy, they demanded that you get to a physical therapist or a medical doctor until quite recently. So the way that medicine set out its power structure is it dominated the political landscape, and they did it through a very unique kind of way, that a medical act became defined as any act done by a medical physician. Uh-huh. Didn't matter what it was. It's the only group that got this, right? And then they got what's called a law of trespass. Mm-hmm. A law of trespass is when not only do you have a scope of practice that's written into the law and given it as your scope of practice, but you can prosecute anybody practicing without a license. So the way that, that chiropractors were put into prison right up until the late 50s was practicing medicine without a license. So if you define by statute that a medical act is anything done by a medical profession, then of course anyone who's doing those acts, who isn't a medical doctor by definition, is actually practicing medicine without a license.
Right.
So all the alternatives faced the possibility of being prosecuted, right, and actually being put in prison for doing that. So then if you think about, okay, then how do all the health professions get their own scope of practice? They have to get it at the expense of medicine. And there's only two ways of doing it. Either you go under referral or you compete, right? Mm-hmm. Osteopaths came to an agreement and went into medicine, right? Chiropractors refused. And so did naturopathy, homeopathy. Well, homeopathy was probably never invited, but the others refused. And they said, okay, we're going to fight to get our own scope of practice and legitimation. So what happened was kind of interesting. There was a trial called the Wilkes trial. And this has had a huge influence on the whole of integrative medicine in America, though most people don't know about it. Wilkes and I think seven other chiropractors sued the AMA and several other organizations under the antitrust law. Now, antitrust law in America is quite interesting. You cannot restrict trade, right, under the antitrust law. And the real neat little thing about it is you can't do it by saying you're acting in the public interest. So when the Wilkes trial first happened, and in the first trial that occurred, the judge allowed the medics to use as a defense that they act in the public interest, that they excluded chiropractors because they were acting to protect the public, that these were a danger, and therefore they were a form of quackery, and the public had to be protected. Right. Well, under the first judge misinterpreted the law. The chiropractors appealed it, and the judge said you cannot use that as a defense, and she banned that as a defense. Once that had happened, they were able to show that the restriction of chiropractors that happened by the AMA was to do with competition. And the reason they were able to do this, Wayne, is because in the 1960s, the AMA had started a committee on quackery. I mean, it was so effective, it's quite scary how brilliant this was. But what you do is you have a code of ethics that say, under code of ethics, that a medical doctor can have no relationship to a quack or quackery. Mm-hmm. You can't refer to quackery. You can't accept referrals from them. You couldn't go and teach in their institutions. You couldn't rent space to them. You couldn't rent space from them. The only thing you could actually do, funnily enough, is have a sexual relationship, because that wasn't banned. You could marry one.
Yeah.
But everything else was void, right? And if you did it, you ran the chance of using your license. Not only was that in the code of ethics of the AMA, but they got that code of ethics adopted by the American Hospital Association. A whole bunch of subsidiary organizations adopted the code of ethics. Now, if you look at on the surface, it looks like that's what you'd want to do. You really don't want to be having a relationship with quackery, right? Mm-hmm. Except that the minutes for the committee on quackery were leaked. No one knows who leaked, but he's referred to as sore throat as opposed to deep throat. It's never been identified to my knowledge. But anyway, all the documents from the Committee on Quackery in the 60s were made public, or they were leaked. Really? It turned out the Committee on Quackery had no other purpose. Its only agenda was the extermination of chiropractic, and it's in the minutes.
Really?
So over all these years, they tried to block chiropractors getting grants from NIH. They made sure chiropractors were in the university. They made sure they never got to hospitals. And anybody that decided they would let them in would get a telephone call, if you like, and they would be told that you're in violation of the code of ethics, right? No doctor could have a relationship with. The Wilkes trial, the chiropractors won. The actual AMA tried to appeal it to the Supreme Court, and it was held up on the appeal court, the Third Circuit Appeal Court, I think. They upheld it, said there was no violation of law, there was no grounds for an appeal. They appealed to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court wouldn't hear it. So in actual fact, the end of that was they were forbidden now to have a conspiracy against chiropractors. They weren't allowed to lobby against them. They couldn't force them to have a relationship, but they couldn't do what they were doing against them before. From that point onwards, for the first time in history, hospitals could actually bring chiropractors in, and some of them did, right? But anyone now could actually have a relationship with chiropractors, so medical doctors could. So that made integrative medicine for the first time possible. Now, integrative medicine, the social revolution that was occurring that I got interested in, most sociologists should be, and some of them have been, was for the first time we started to see, after 100 years of hostility, we started to see CAM groups and biomedicine forming new kind of partnerships and relationships in a way that before the Wilkes trial wasn't actually possible, or very unlikely to happen. For the first time, it became possible even legally to do this, right? But even socially acceptable. So now you started to see what was very exciting, and for me as a sociologist, quite significant, because it seemed to me that not having the CAM group and biomedicine talk to each other was not a good thing. It's not in the interest of the patient not to talk between these providers. Right. And if you remember Eisenberg's study in the 90s from Harvard showed how many of the American people were using CAM, how much they were spending to do it, and that they weren't telling their physician.
Right.
And those three things, the Eisenberg study coming along after the Wilkes trial, had a huge impact because a lot of medical institutions, hospitals thought, wow, we would actually increase the safety of our patients if we did ask them about CAM and got them to talk about it. And then someone thought, wow, they're spending, and at that time I think Eisenberg said it was $12 billion, it's now $30 billion.
Right.
But a lot of hospitals thought we wouldn't mind getting a piece of that. I mean, that's a lot of money out of pocket. It turned out they're spending more out of pocket than they were on medicine. So a lot of institutions, just from a financial point of view, said, wow. A lot of others started to think, well, integrative medicine might be the way to go for giving better quality healthcare. And a lot of very courageous institutions did, mainly with the help of philanthropists, I should say, but a lot of them others didn't. And so for the first time, integrative medicine initially just meant some kind of new kind of partnership. And sometimes it was when medicine was still dominant. Sometimes it was a true partnership. Sometimes it was adjunct therapy. The partnerships and what constitute integrative medicine is highly variable. But at least you could now have these new kind of relationships without actually you losing your license if you did it, or being held up under a code of ethics for a violation of the ethical code. And so now you start to get what was quite exciting from a sociological point of view. This is like a mini social revolution. It's like, you know, the first time China started meeting with the West, you know, when Nixon went to China. Right. That was a huge impact, right? Well, this is kind of the same thing on a different level. So that's how I got interested.
Is this sort of like the public almost inadvertently taking their power, or at least the power now being acknowledged that it's in the public, because it's the public use of this, and it's the public payment for this, and it's the public interest for this that seems to be the primary driver of the shift in power. I mean, if I understand you correctly, you're saying that the tools that are utilized to keep non-mainstream practices out, things like non-scientific or non-licensing or ethics rules or these types of things, are really simply arms of use of social power. They're simply tools of social power. And until the public actually says, yes, this is something that we want and we're going to take it over, make decisions for ourselves, begin to implement it, begin to pay for it, the power structures can keep things at bay for a while. Is that right?
Yeah, absolutely.
So this is a classic civil rights approach, isn't it?
It's civil rights. And it's all about power. And that's exactly what happened. There's a couple of things that happened that were driven by the public, though. In the civil rights movement in the 60s, remember the civil rights had spillover. So we got Ralph Nader. Mm-hmm. So now we got the consumer rights. Then we got the gay movement, and we got movements for them. We got the feminist movement. And many of these actually made health, particularly the gay movement because of the HIV crisis, and particularly feminism. Feminism made health a center tenet of their political movement. And one of the first political bodies to do this, and remember, out of Boston came Our Bodies, Ourself, which was a manifesto for the women's movement, and they wanted to take back control. Birthing became a natural thing and not an illness, right? And so women, in a very fundamental way, started to contest the power of mainstream medicine, particularly around psychiatric issues. Why was it they're the only ones who seem to be neurotic, and they're the only ones who are getting these psychotropic drugs for neuroticism? Men never seem to get that, right? Which was kind of sad.
Right.
So, and then what happened with the Ralph Nader movement, it was applied to automobiles and so on, but what people forget is the consumer movement started to be applied in the health field. And so you got this incredible movement where the public started to have a demand about not only the shape of their own healthcare, but also public delivery of healthcare. So from the 60s onwards, increasingly, you got groups that were starting to contest the power of medicine. At the same time, so those civil rights movement started to undermine the dominance of medicine. And what also added to that was sociology. From up until the 60s, sociologists portrayed medicine as the pinnacle of professions. That if you wanted to know what a true profession was, you looked at medicine, right? And then you looked at all the privileges and responsibilities. And professionalism in the early years of sociology was tended to be portrayed as a public good, that it was good to let them be self-disciplining and good to let them have a code of ethics, which meant they act in the patient interest and all that. And so the state turned over to the professions incredible power on the basis that there was a social contract. And the contract was, you get all these privileges, but here's the responsibilities, and you're to meet the health of the public, and you're to act in the public interest. The patient's interest comes forth. It's called credat emptor as opposed to caveat emptor. Mm-hmm. So the relationship was that always the public interest, the patient interest comes first, the doctor's interest comes second. In the 60s, that the sociologists started publishing articles, Friedson was the classic person, on medical dominance. And particularly with the women's movement, we come to see that medicine wasn't acting in the public interest, it was acting like a union, that the AMA was a union, right? And that if you look at what happened, that incredibly, the professions led also by medicine were acting in the professional interest and not the public interest. And out of the critiques that came out of sociology, and out of the critiques that came out of the consumer movement, and then the feminist movement or the gay movement, you got a tremendous challenge towards medical dominance. And nowhere is that clearer than in the feminist movement. We're going to take back birthing. So we developed birthing centers. And we actually said, you know, pregnancy is not an illness, it's a natural event. It's a delivery, you know, labor. I mean, even the words, you see. So you started to see a movement where in the 60s, people started to confront medical dominance, and not just medical dominance, the dominance of law. I mean, think about it. When we were growing up, the three pinnacle professions were the priesthood, the lawyer, and medicine. Look what's happened to the three of them. Priesthood, I mean, now through sexual abuse and all kinds of things, has been totally undermined as being the dominant profession. Law, I mean, we make jokes about, how do I know when my lawyer's lying? It's when his lips move. I mean, that would never have occurred in the 30s and 40s. You wouldn't have heard that kind of joke. But people come to see that professions, instead of meeting the terms of the social contract, were abusing it. And what they were abusing was their power. And so now, Now comes the Wilkes trial in the 80s, along in the middle of that. So you have all these social movements going on that are chipping away at the power of medicine. And then you get the Wilkes trial. Now it's open sesame, because now not only do you have the consumer movement demanding to have a say about healthcare, demanding to have their kind of healthcare covered and recognized. And remember that it was the social movements that got chiropractors legitimated. It was voters that fought for and got congressmen to support and got state legislators to pass the chiropractic acts. That was based on a huge movement by the patient population of chiropractors. Same for naturopathy, homeopathy, all of them, right? So that sort of, you have these social forces, have these social movements occurring. Now you have a legal decision. And so after the Wilkes trial, you've got the movement towards having relationships, and now it's legally possible because you've moved that code of ethics that stopped it. So now from the mid-80s onwards, now you truly can have integrative medicine, where before, and you've got increasing demand for it. So I always say that integrative medicine was driven by consumer. In fact, to be quite honest, the public had already integrated healthcare. Right. They were already integrating their chiropractic care with their naturopathic care and with their medical care. They were doing it. The only ones who hadn't done it and were having difficulty was professionals. The public's been doing it for 100 years. So there's nothing new about integrative medicine at one level. At the level of the public, it always was. I mean, chiropractic patients always tend to keep an MD. They weren't using chiropractic exclusively.
Where do you think this is going? I mean, I often hear people say now that, well, if we just were reimbursed, or if the economic incentives were changed. But now I'm wondering if the economic levers are not just handles on the power structure also, and aren't necessarily the solution to that. Is there an issue around the medical industry in which integrative practices or some aspect of this needs to be impacted? What makes me wonder about this is that the IOM report that came out recently that traced the trends in health outcomes in the U.S. compared to, I think it was 16 other developed countries, showed a steady decline in the vast majority of the public's health outcomes across 30 years in some cases. I mean, this is devastating. The inequities broadening during that period of time. Is the inequity issue the key area? Is it an industry component? Are economics really the solution? Should we be focused on, are we undermining prosperity by failing to focus on a broader aspect of health and health creation?
I think the inequities is the key. I mean, I think if you look at the bad health outcome stats for the United States, it's because we've tolerated gross inequalities in delivery of health care. So if you look at what drives those bad figures, one is partly because we keep people alive quite long, and right. So therefore a lot of those costs come at the end of life. But the other is just that different certain social groups in America make those stats look a lot worse because they don't get an equal share of the resources for healthcare, right? So right. So we know the inequities have a huge driving impact on the economic cost. And then when they do get ill, it's very costly for us, right? So, and to come back to the CAM part of this kind of story, the part, what's happened to the CAM group, because this is really like a parallel healthcare system that wasn't under the funded healthcare system, basically, it increasingly became a healthcare delivery system for the well-off. I mean, most of the money, that's the $30 billion that's spent on complementary alternative medicine, is out of pocket. I mean, mm-hmm. It's the people paying for their own healthcare. But that means that the poor and the people who don't have economic resources are not getting access to CAM. So CAM has increasingly become a middle-class kind of
right.
Thing. And chiropractors initially were very blue-collar. It was the unions and the workers who couldn't afford to be off work and the self-employed that used chiropractic originally and the rural farmers. It wasn't the middle class. Right. Now it's pretty much middle class and above right. because they all have their chiropractor. But it turned out that wasn't the driving force historically for chiropractic, right. but it is now. And so now you have, if you look at this kind of what's driving the very bad outcome data on American health, well, it's partly that we had 40 million people that weren't even covered at all of any kind of right. insurance. So the American Health Care Act is trying to take care of some of that. But there's no doubt that coverage or reimbursement is a huge barrier in a whole bunch of ways. One, as I pointed out, it means that people without the resources can't use it, right? But the second thing, it has to do with legitimation, that quite often in the public's mind, if it's not covered by health insurance, it's less legitimate. So quite often, one of the downstream consequences of coverage might be that a healthcare that may be very effective for the person, maybe homeopathy, right? That is, doesn't have the side effects that they will have if they're going to mainstream, and doesn't have the costs associated with mainstream, doesn't get used. It's not utilized, it's not used early, it's not used preventively, it's not used in a whole bunch of it. Acupuncture would be a good example. Yoga right. could be a good example. Meditation would be a good example. Right. They're not used because they're seen as somehow not legitimate. Whether we like it or not, coverage by insurance or by the government, Medicare and Medicaid and so on, coverage confers legitimacy in the minds of a lot of people, right? They think, well, if it's not covered, then there's something wrong about it, you know? And the problem with that is that then that means it's not utilized. So I think the economic drivers, and particularly for the care providers themselves, I mean, that they can provide really good care, they don't get reimbursed, you know? And therefore, if you're giving a 40-minute, you know, visit with and taking care of whole systems, the whole person and the whole system's care, becomes very difficult to do that. There's no billing code for you. There's no coverage for you. You know, it's challenging.
So help me understand this here. This the Institute, the Samuel Institute, is, as you know, is focused on healing,
right.
sort of understanding the inherent capacity of individuals to recover, to repair, to reintegrate, to become whole again. And so that process, that inherent process, often involves self-care in many cases, things that don't require a profession. They don't require a lot of resources. They require a knowledge base. They require a set of behaviors and practices and skills that people have. They require access to healthy abilities to have healthy foods and behaviors and this type of thing. Are you saying that in many ways the healthcare industry or our society, not just the healthcare industry, but they're the arm of doing this, has delegitimized that? I mean, are we not simply marginalizing professions, but we're actually marginalizing our own inherent capacity to heal in order to drive a power structure that benefits from that?
Well, you're absolutely right. I mean, if you go to a university and look at the most elaborate building on the campus, it'll be medicines. I mean, it's a shrine. I mean, it's a very expensive shrine. They will have the most research dollars. They'll probably have the biggest fund of any of any faculty on campus. So the way we've actually done it, the way we've put the resources in, is in what I call trauma and pathology, right? Type pathology. And while you're absolutely right that what we would really like to move towards is upfront try and stop people getting disease and certainly try and stop them being involved in serious trauma, right? Crash hats and all kinds of things to do that. But the problem with that, Wayne, is that people need as much help to find their way through wellness as they do through illness. And what we've done is we're actually rewarding people for being ill.
Right.
I mean, in a very perverse kind of way. And I'm not saying that you shouldn't take care of people if they've got serious disease. I'm not saying that. But what I'm saying is, in a very perverse way, they get the best stuff when they're really ill. And it's like a reinforcement for not actually taking care of their own.
Right.
I mean, a lot of those disease states, things like diabetes.
Here's your candy. You can have it when you're sick.
They could have been avoided by what I call lifestyle changes, right? We all know that, but the problem is that we reward them for actually, you know, I mean, in the ancient Chinese healthcare system, the physician to the emperor got paid as long as the emperor stayed well. And as soon as the emperor started getting ill, they started reducing the payment to them, you know, so they were reinforced economically by keeping someone well, not by treating someone when they're ill. And if you remember the book Erewhon by Samuel Butler, the very perverse thing was that criminals were treated as though they're sick and sick people were put in jail, right? And it's kind of a satire about the perverse way we do these kind of rewards. And the problem that we have built into the system, we've built a system that does not reward people for being well and doesn't reward people to help them being well. And what people forget is that every culture that I've ever heard of, and I've never heard one that wasn't, has some kind of healthcare provider. witch, shaman, witch doctor, doctor, whatever. I mean, there's something about the human condition when we are confronted with illness or even wellness issues, we can't manage it by ourselves. There's something about our psyche or our anthropological needs that doesn't allow us to do that. And I would say that the wellness part, unfortunately, the people need as much help in educating and knowing that delivery system as they do for the illness side. Mm-hmm. And so CAM providers have actually largely been wellness providers.
Right. So this isn't simply only a matter of marginalization of a particular profession or the poor or a particular ethnic or racial group or sexual orientation group. This is really a marginalization of the healing capacity of human beings in general. So everybody at all levels ought to be concerned about this.
It's marginalization of a way of thinking about, yes. I mean, it's a philosophical marginalization mm-hmm. in a way, because it marginalizes the whole notion of wellness.
Yes.
And the truth is that ultimately what you want people is to be well. Even when they've got serious pathology, mm-hmm. you want them to still have a quality of life. And that's the thing about wellness. Wellness doesn't just mean absence of disease. It means being able to function as much as possible in your capacity to function because of a disease in socially important ways, and to live a quality of life even if you're being, you know, if you've been struck down with some quite very serious kind of disease and maybe in some way challenged. And so I think what's really significant is to marginalize that whole way of thinking, which may be the only solution we're going to have to deal with chronic illness, right? That it's very clear that the sort of dominant paradigm that we have within what we call biomedicine doesn't seem to be very good at dealing with those kind of lifestyle things, and certainly is proving to be very ineffective when it comes to chronic illness. We need to have a whole different paradigm or way of thinking about it. So that's the serious marginalization, that to marginalize what would be health enhancement, preventive care, health, all those kinds of things got marginalized, and we don't put resources into it. Right?
So really this is about legitimization of a way of thinking, of a concept, how is that done? Where are we going with this? Where do you think the focus should be in the next 10 years, 20 years in these areas?
Well, not only did we marginalize it, but we actually prosecuted and treated very badly those who held to it, which is virtually all the CAM community. They were isolated, they were put in prison, they were, you know, delegitimated, they were treated as marginal, they were told they were quacks and so on. So we even went after those who had it.
But also the public, you said. Even the people that walked in, we wouldn't ask them about it, we wouldn't talk to them about it, we wouldn't pay for it.
If they did tell you, you'd tell them that's quackery, you shouldn't use it, right? So we did that too. So we marginalized the people using it, that's true. And chiropractic was labeled by sociologists as a marginal profession, that was the term that was invented for them, right? So we did that. So where are we going to go? Well, I mean, from an interesting point of view as a sociologist, and even as a health services researcher, if you take the position that this marginalization and this hostility was never in the public interest, it was not in the patient's interest ever, not for them to talk, have their providers talking to each other, because there are interactive effects. I mean, if you're taking certain kind of supplements and you're taking prescription drugs, there are some potential side effects there. And with all due respect, it's better for your doctor and that to know what you're using and think about that, and for those people to actually co-manage you than not, right? So from a quality of care point of view and for good outcome of care point of view, that hostility and that marginalization was never in the patient's interest, and it certainly cannot have been in the public interest. So what I think is interesting is I think integrative healthcare, and I won't, that's really the better term, the more general term, integrated healthcare, I think, offers a possibility, a social revolution, if you like, that's starting to chip away at that, where we now see, you'll now find chiropractors throughout the military and throughout the VA, and you and I both know 15 years ago they wouldn't let them in the door. That's been amazing. And when the evaluation we're doing that moment, when you go to talk in those institutions about what they think about these guys, you get glowing reports saying, and I recall the comment of an orthopedic surgeon in a top military hospital said to me, the only two questions I have, Ian, is why weren't they here sooner and why don't we have more men in them? And I said, you realize 15 years ago, your particularly orthopedic surgery, you wouldn't have had them in here. You would have blocked them, right? and East Einhorn. And so, so there you see a transformation in a very short period where now institutions are starting to access care that's in the interest of their patients and really getting results at that. And you can go to the military institutions, you know, Wayne, and there's a queue. You can't get into the chiropractor. It's an 8 to 10 week delay to get an appointment.
Right.
You can't get enough of them. And so what you think, well, why didn't that happen for the last 100 years? Well, put that aside. We know why it didn't happen. The question now is, okay, how do we develop systems where that integration can occur? And that's still a challenge because there's no one definition of integrative medicine, and they're all over the map. It's an emerging field, and you expect that, I know, but different institutions are building different models. And what we want to know is, how do you build the model? So we need a huge amount of descriptive data to show, to say, what is it that's being done under the name of integrative healthcare or medicine? What is it they're actually doing, and who's in partnership, and what are the partnerships, right? Are you sure it's not just medicine stealing it, right? So that's a question you want to ask. And then secondly, you want to know, okay, what outcomes? Do people actually get better under integrative medicine than under just, say, biomedicine or CAM by itself? That's an empirical question. As a researcher, that's what I want to know. Has it increased the quality of care? Does it help with the delivery care? And do you get better outcomes? At the end of the day, is the public better served by having integrated healthcare than not having it? And also to do that, you need to know what constitutes integration, right? So that's, if you ask me, the rigorous kind of research you need. You really need a lot of rigorous research to discover what it is. What is it they're doing? What is it they're claiming to do? And then I think what you really want to do is start to do what I call comparative effectiveness. What are the outcomes? Just forget about the efficacy at the moment. Let's see, are they getting outcomes? Are they getting better results? Are they delivering a form of care that's to the advantage of the patient, right? That's what you want to know. Right.
So I know that RAND Corporation that you work for and Samueli Institute have joined in a partnership to explore these kinds of questions and are now looking to build a bigger infrastructure, a bigger center that can really address them in a more impactful way. Research on description, outcomes, quality, patient satisfaction that we're talking about, and so that would help accelerate this process. Yeah. But what I hear in the thread of what you're talking about is that the public is in many ways at the center of the power shift here. And is there something that the public can do to help accelerate that process?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, there's no doubt for me that the integrative healthcare has been driven by the public, basically, because they were doing it all the time anyway. But they started to demand to have their different kinds of things recognized. And they demanded to have a say, not only their own healthcare, but they wanted to have a say in the shape of the healthcare system. So there's, and you can look at every interest group that, you know, the one that does it for autistic children. I mean, there's so many powerful interest groups, and HIV was a good example where the community rose up and said, we're going to have a say in the research agenda here, and we're going to be involved in it. You're just not going to come out and study us. We want to be involved intimately into telling you what the agenda should be, what the question should be, about how you go about it, and so on. So the HIV movement was a radical movement with regard to research and gender within the NIH. They really participated very fully. Now with PCORI, we see the same thing, that the public and the community and the stakeholders absolutely have to be involved, and the questions are going to be answered, the questions that providers and patients want answered, not questions that scientists want answered. Right?
So what you're saying is that the listener of this podcast, which is the public, right. We're all members of the public, right. They really need to demand that these things be recognized, that there be more efforts and investment in these areas, not only integrative medicine, which is a venue for that, but really that there's more attention to healing, within the delivery system and within the policies and the investments that we make in all areas.
Absolutely, Wayne. And I think one of the things I need to ask the question about, and someone needs to ask it quite bluntly, is around 50, most surveys show around 50% of the population using competent alternative medicine of some kind, and it's been increasing. As Eisenberg showed in the early 90s, late 90s, it went up.
Right.
So we know it's increasing. So if, let's say it is 50%, it's roughly percent in most Western countries, that's about what it is. And for cancer patients, around 80%, right? So
right.
now you think about that for a minute and then look at the budget of the NIH. Out of the billions of money that have grants they have, less than 1% is actually given to the National Center of Competent Alternative Medicine.
Significantly less than 1%.
I think it's 0.04%,
I believe.
The last time they gave me the figures, that's what I calculated as.
0.04%.
0.04%. Now, you could say, well, okay, NIH does do some research outside of NCAM. That's true, but not very much.
Right.
So I would say even if you added it all together, and I actually got the figures that they could give me for the whole of NIH, and it still was less than 1%. So 50% of the population use it, less than 1% of NIH budget is actually investigating. Now, even if you think all this stuff is nonsense, right? Even if you think it is quackery, surely what we actually need is some pretty serious resources to research it. And if it follows like any other kind of scientific endeavor, some of it will turn out like shark cartilage might turn out to be of no use, right? And some of it will turn out to be useful. I mean, history is not a very good way of selecting what is good and what's not, because tradition will keep using stuff like leeches even if there was no use for it.
Right.
But it turns out leeches turns out to have some use.
Right, bloodletting.
Bloodletting turns out to actually, people with serious liver diseases, bloodletting might have saved
might
their
have
life.
Some value.
So you know that given how science works, I'd expect that the more research we do, we'll sort out the wheat from the chaff, right? But you can't do that if you're spending less than 1%. So if I was the public, I think the public has the right to demand that NIH is a publicly funded institution and is supposed to be responsive to the health needs of the American public. So I think a very good argument can be made that, excuse me, but you know, more than 1% should be spent on something that 50% of the population is using, even if you think it's wrong. And as you know, Wayne, because you were there, there was huge scientific opposition to even having NCAM, to having them have anything, never alone less than 1%. I mean, they didn't want to give them that. How do you justify that? Are you responsible? And this is what the new PCORI is saying, that we now have to be responsible to the needs of the public. Well, surely, if the public's spending $30 billion a year out of pocket of its own money, and 50% of them are actually doing it, and 80% in cancer, I'm sorry, but that's time we start asking actually where the resource is going. And I think what PCORI has signaled, and what the American Healthcare Act has signaled, is we need to move from an agenda that's determined by scientists and academics to an agenda that's determined by providers and the public.
The evolution towards whole person healing has been gradual, but has caught momentum in the last 20 years as patients everywhere are seeing that their overall health is in their own hands. The public interest for holistic health care has been the driver for many changes over the last 50 years. As Dr. Coulter points out, the public has made use of non-mainstream practices long before physicians caught up with this movement. Access to holistic healing practices often requires self-initiated investigation, as patients use these practices from an industry that only slowly progresses toward mainstream use and integration of care.